Today we celebrate the solemnity of the Most Holy Trinity. So today we honor God as one God, but we honor the three persons of the Trinity, and each of the persons of the Trinity are fully God. Some people get this kind of confused, and it's easy to understand. It's a mystery. It's easy to understand that they would get this confused. But the mystery of the Trinity, that is something difficult to understand. And part of the reason we have such difficulty understanding is because most of the information we get it from the material world that we live in. But God is pure spirit. The angelic beings are also pure spirit. So God is a different kind of being. He's very different from all of us, even though we could say that we are created in the image of God, which means that we have an immaterial or spiritual soul. We have intellect and will, or the freedom or the ability to choose freely in our souls. So all of these things make us like God, but at the same time, we are very different from God. Notice in today's gospel reading, when our Lord sends out his disciples to baptize all nations, he says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Notice he says in the name, not in the names of. In other words, if there was three separate beings, then it would make sense to say in the names of. So it's not three separate beings. It's one God. And the nature of God is such that he is a trinity of persons. There have been various people who have tried to explain this in various different ways. And the best kind of explanation that I heard is that, you know, think of ourselves as human beings. We have a conscious awareness of ourselves that animals do not have. So when I think of myself in my consciousness, what I'm really doing is I'm creating an image, or I have an image of myself in my conscious awareness of myself. Now, because I'm a limited being, I'm a created being, my ability to create this image of myself or to be consciously aware of myself is very, very limited. It's not a perfect being. And it's just an image in my mind. So it only exists as an image. But when we think of God, well, God is not limited in his abilities. God is all powerful. He is all knowing. He knows himself perfectly. So in the case of God, he too has this conscious awareness of himself. And he forms this image of himself in his mind. But in his mind, this image of himself is perfect. And because this image of himself is really himself, it's not just perfect, but it's also alive. It's conscious, but it's distinct from the one who is the one who's thinking of himself. In other words, the Father thinks of himself, and in doing so, creates the Son. From all eternity, the Father has this conscious awareness of himself. So the Son is identical to the Father, but the Son proceeds or comes from the Father. Therefore, the Father is greater than the Son. So when we read the passages of Scripture in the New Testament that refer to the Trinitarian nature of God, it makes perfect sense. Now, the Holy Spirit is a little bit harder to understand, but the Holy Spirit is the love between the Father and the Son. And when we love someone, we take that person into our heart or into our will. So we associate with the image of that person. So in the act of love, the Father and the Son loving each other, they form this image of themselves, which is really the love they have for each other, or the image that is within their love for each other. And this is the Holy Spirit. So a little bit harder to understand. But each one of those persons is distinct from the other, and yet each one is fully the same as the other. So there's only one God, and within this being that we call God, this process takes place from all eternity. So there's three persons in the Trinity. Each one is fully God, but there's only one God. So when the second person becomes man, It's the second person who takes on our human nature. You know, some people have said, well, the three persons are just really three different ways in which God acts upon mankind. No. So it's not different ways or modes of acting, but rather there are actually three distinct persons. But the Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Father. And yet when we think of their being, what they are in their essence, the Son is the same essence as the Father. This is why Jesus, you know, he could say that he and the Father are one, that he is God. And this is why also Jesus can say, I only do what I see my Father doing, because they are so intimately united. As you know, St. John, the beloved apostle, the beloved evangelist, tells us that God is love. That God is love. What is love? If you were to define love just in your own words, well, it's a force. It's more than just a feeling. It's a commitment. It's a concern for the well-being of others. So what St. John is telling us, not that God is loving. Yes, God is loving, but he's telling us that God is love. And to even to understand that statement, it's kind of like a mystery. But the only way that this statement of St. John can be true is that if God is a very active being in and of himself, in other words, this process of love is taking place within God at all times from all eternity. And this is also why God is totally and completely fulfilled in and of himself. God didn't need to create creation. God didn't need any of us. He certainly doesn't need us to make him happy. How can we make him happy? So God is totally fulfilled, totally happy in and of himself. And, you know, in his mind, he knows all things. He knows all possible creations that he could have made. So when we are baptized, the Most Holy Trinity dwells within our souls, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And as long as we remain in a state of grace, the Holy Trinity continues to dwell in our souls. In other words, we are united to God. If we commit a mortal sin, we separate ourselves from God. Now, the sacraments nourish this life of God within us. So when we receive Holy Communion, it is God, the second person of the Trinity, that is entering into us. When we are confirmed, we receive an abundance, an overflowing of the Holy Spirit. In other words, we receive even more. So we have this potential, this capacity to receive more of God, to be filled with a greater abundance of God's presence within us. And this is what sanctity is all about. So the closer we are to God, the more we become like God. In the early church, there were various church fathers that actually made the statement that God became man so that man can become God. And in saying this, they didn't imply that we would become gods separate from God, but that we would become like God, that we would be transformed into a new creation to be the way that God is. And if we realize this, and if we understand how magnificent God is in and of himself, we would definitely want this. So through baptism, and especially once we die and enter into heaven, in other words, we will participate in the life of the Most Holy Trinity. We will know as God knows. We will understand as God understands. Will we understand and know perfectly the way that God knows and understands? No. Our level of knowledge, our level of understanding, our level of love will be determined by how close we are to God during this life. So especially our love of God. So how much we love God, that will help to determine how close we are to God in heaven and after the final resurrection of all the dead. And when we think of the lives of various saints, you know, St. Padre Pio, like he had the ability to understand different language. In other words, God gave him this knowledge because God dwelt within him. Saint Padre Pio also had the ability to bilocate, to be in more than one place at the same time. God is present everywhere. So in other words, with God, we have the potential even now to be transformed, to be a new creation, to be more like God, to be more like Christ, the way that Christ was. So when we think of all these saints, you know, Saint Anthony of Padua, Saint Francis of Assisi, Mother Teresa of Calcutta, we see God in them. We see some aspect of God in them. We see some aspect of Christ in their lives. And we see the tremendous good that they do for all of mankind. So the reality is that you and I, we have the potential, we have the ability to do the very same things, to be transformed, to be filled with the love of God, the knowledge of God, the wisdom of God, the understanding of God, all these things. But the choice is ours. Let us do what we can to honor the persons of the Most Holy Trinity, and let us ask them to transform us to be ever more fully the way that they are. Thank you.